Prairie Mosaic is funded by the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund with money from the vote of the people of Minnesota on November 4th, 2008, the North Dakota Council on the Arts, and by the members of Prairie Public.
Welcome to Prairie Mosaic, a patchwork of stories about the arts, culture, and history in our region.
Hi, I'm Barb Gravel.
And I'm Matt Olean. On this edition of Prairie Mosaic, we'll visit a museum dedicated to sugar beets, look into the world of costume design, and listen to regional musicians perform some country rock originals. Damber, Subba, and Punya Ghimirey are musicians who perform traditional Nepali music. Originally from Bhutan, they both eventually made their way to Fargo. Now they are preserving their tradition by sharing their music with new audiences.
When we sing, it brings a great pleasure for us to perform in front of people.
When I start performing, I feel really proud and happy because all people start cheering up. They say that you did a really great job. That motivates me to go further.
We came from Bhutan to eastern part of Nepal, and we stayed there in one of the refugee camps. We stayed there almost 19 years. And then it was in 2010, I came to United States in Fargo. When I was back in Bhutan, I learned my traditional songs from my elders. They used to sing, dance in our village. I used to go there, watch them dance, watch them sing. So I also got motivated to learn our traditional songs.
I used to live in another refugee camp. So we were not together at that time, but I used to hear his name so many times. I got a chance to meet Damber when he was performing in one of the stage program that was for a cultural show.
We used to gather sometimes in a special occasion. So from that time also, he used to learn from me. And he used to ask some questions about music. First, he came to Fargo. And when I came here, he knew that I came here in Fargo too. So he just phoned me. I was very happy. I have got one friend to keep going my music.
I was so very happy that he came to Fargo. Even if he was not coming here, if he was going to another state, in U.S., I was thinking that I will maybe move to that state or do something to learn from him. From Damber, I came to know that there is a program that gives opportunity to learn music. I decided to join in the program. It is a very great program. It does take care of our music. And we also flourish our music to our coming generations.
Harmonium is kind of a universal musical instrument in any kind of genre. Like we have in Nepalese music, we have pop genre, we have rock song too, we have typical traditional song, we have folk song too. So in each and every genre, we use this instrument. It helps a lot for the musicians and for the vocalist also.
I actually like singing better, and I also like to write a song, like lyrics. To sing correctly and perfectly, we need musical instrument. For our songs, for our cultural song or any type of song, harmonium is the best musical instrument. So I am learning harmonium through this program also. Damber is very good teacher because he's very detailed in everything. If I jump very small thing, then he will notice that and he correct that thing then and there. So he's really a good teacher.
Sim sim pani paryo pakhaima. Sim sim pani paryo pakhaima.
When I was learning harmonium from Damber, we decided to write one song. I got to listen to so many songs from our great singers. I tried to get those words and I tried to get the ideas from those songs. When I finished writing that song, I gave it to my teacher Damber and he started composing the music on that.
The problem is like we don't have a professional instrumentalist here. After I wrote a melody for that words, we sent it to Nepal. So there we have a professional instrumentalist and they made a track. We have a community here in Fargo. So we celebrate our cultural festivals. We organize a musical program, musical event. And those musical events for us is the place to perform, present our arts.
Sano ma sano gai ko bacho bhirai ma ram ram chodera jana sakina maile.
I just like to tell our upcoming boys and girls, our generations, that if they are really interested in knowing our cultural things, they can contact us and learn from us. We are happy to share our ideas.
Back in Bhutan, when I heard my elders singing, playing musical instrument, it was fun for me at that time. I didn't feel the importance of music because I was very little child and then I was just enjoying with them only. Now I really feel what I have learned from them is great knowledge. This music is kind of identity for us. Music is very important for us.
Camilla Morrison is a costume designer at the University of North Dakota in Grand Forks. Her vibrant personality and attention to detail are just two of the reasons that students appreciate her teachings and her talent.
One of the things that I would love people to know about costume design is all of the work that goes into each tiny decision that's made about what you see in movies, on the screen, on the stage. Everything has a very purposeful and meaningful decision behind it. I grew up in the Republic of the Marshall Islands on an island named Kwajalein. On the islands, it's a very colorful culture that has ceremonies where different things are celebrated in different ways, and I always found that to be really beautiful and very theatrical. So before I even realized it, I was interested in how we represent ourselves through clothing. That's ultimately the very beginning, how I got started with costume design. I moved to Grand Forks to take the job at UND to become their costume designer instructor. I love teaching. That's one of my greatest passions. I always knew I wanted to be a teacher in some capacity. One of the greatest joys of teaching is helping people to realize that everybody has a creative streak and everybody has the capacity to have ideas and grow in their own designer identity.
One of my favorite things is like pattern making and draping, and she's taught me everything about that. From the beginning, she's kind of thrown me into like projects like that that I didn't know would lead into like pattern making and draping. Not having that knowledge and then her being like, try this thing out, and then it works out and I'm like, wow, I want to do this again.
And then just go for it. Do some bold cutting.
On the same side?
I think, yeah. There are so many things that happen during the planning of your favorite shows and the things that you see on stage. We have a process before anything hits the stage where we will read the script, analyze the script. We have meetings with the director and other designers. But the costume designer stays involved in choosing fabrics if we're going to be making some costumes, which we do here in this shop. And we also will find things that we might use from storage, or we might buy or alter things that we found. There have been many fittings that I've been in where the actors will come in and put on their costume and say, "Wow, I really start to feel like my character now." I got my MFA in costume technology and design from Louisiana State University. And as a part of that program, we have to do a thesis project. And I knew coming into the program that I wanted to do something outside of the ordinary. I have always sort of had this question of what does it mean to be a woman in the world? I think it's partially because I grew up in another country and I got to see that culture and kind of how women fit into that culture. My master's thesis, Nightmares or Dreams 2, is a reflection of, at the time, what I felt it was like to be a woman in the world. My individual artist fellowship from NDCA focuses on a project that I'm doing where I'm interviewing people who identify as women who grew up in North Dakota or who are from North Dakota. I'm asking them to tell me some stories about their ideas about what does feminism mean, what are their views on aging, what are their ideas about being a woman, thinking about just the environment of North Dakota. I'm creating a series of avant-garde costumes to reflect these stories. The stories are not going to be told word for word on stage, rather they're going to be reflected through the costumes. I think that I find a lot of inspiration just in nature and the world that we inhabit. If I have an opportunity to go somewhere else, I find meeting new people to be really inspiring. We choose to put something on every day. Often our clothing is a reflection of how we feel, and I think that if we mindfully are curating our clothing and putting on things that really are reflecting how we feel, our clothing tells us a lot about who we are.
Crookston, Minnesota is the logical location for a sugar beet museum because over 100 years ago, the first beets in the Red River Valley were planted there. Retired sugar beet farmer Alan Dragseth gives us a tour of this small town treasure.
Crookston is the logical place to have a museum because this is the first place that sugar beets were raised in the Red River Valley. In 1918, a guy from Michigan moved here and he'd raised sugar beets in Michigan. He brought some seed along and he planted it in a garden up on the north edge of Crookston. And from there, it's gone to hundreds of thousands of acres in the Red River Valley. Well, we've got lots of beet harvesters. We've gone all the way up to Alvarado and down to Kindred to get machines, and then we restored them back here in the shop and painted them. And after the First World War, there was such a shortage of labor that the government set up a commission of some sort, and they gave out grants to machinery companies to develop something that would harvest the beets without so much labor. And this one behind me is a McCormick Deering one-row lifter, and that was one of the first ones to come out and became the most popular, at least in the valley. It topped, lifted, and cleaned the beets. Then they went up an elevator onto and got dropped onto a moving conveyor belt on a cart, and two people stood on that and picked the beets out of the mud and dropped them down into the cart, and the mud fell off the back of the conveyor belt. I got a whole display along the wall here that's got all kinds of stuff from cameras to telephones to phonographs. Yeah, we've got the beet knives here. like this to pick the beets up off the ground, grab them with their left hand, cut the tops off. They'd use a fork like that. Beet fork looks like a potato fork, but it has knobs on the tips because you're shoveling up off from the ground, and that would help them from digging into the ground. One thing that we've looked for years is a guy that had a welding shop in town here by the name of A.O. Espy. He took Model Ts and put big steel wheels on the back and made a beet cultivator out of them. That was the first power-driven cultivator. I've walked through many, many tree rows and have not been able to find them. We plant about 2 acres of beets here every year and then harvest them on a Sunday afternoon in September. Usually get 400 or 500 people to show up. So we'll have tractor pulling contest, wheat thrashing with a steam engine, and also harvesting sugar beets out here all on that second weekend in September. This fellow that moved here from Michigan and raised the first beets, he dug them by hand and from his garden and put them in gunny sacks and shipped them down to Chaska, Minnesota to the beet factory there. And they wrote back to him that they have good quality and look good, plant some more the next year, and so he did. And then the Northwest Experiment Station out here, it's UMC now, just about right away they started researching them. And then Minnesota Beet Company got interested and they decided that they'd build a factory up here, and it eventually became American Crystal, and from there it's history.
Robb Justice and his band perform a mix of Americana and old country that is reminiscent of the solitude found in wide open landscapes. Enjoy their performance from our series, Prairie Musicians.
I'm gonna climb this mountain until I reach the sky.
you know of an artist, topic, or organization in our region that you think might make for an interesting segment, please contact us at prairiemosaic@prairiepublic.org.
You can watch this and other episodes of Prairie Mosaic on Prairie Public's YouTube channel and follow Prairie Public on social media as well. I'm Barb Gravel.
And I'm Matt Olean. Thanks for joining us for another edition of Prairie Mosaic.
Prairie Mosaic is funded by the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund with money from the vote of the people of Minnesota on November 4th, 2008, the North Dakota Council on the Arts, and by the members of Prairie Public.